स्वादयन्निह सर्वेषां त्रय्यन्तार्थं सुदुर्ग्रहं स्तोत्रयामास योगीन्द्रः तं वन्दे यामुनाह्वयम् नमो नमो यामुनाय यामुनाय नमो नमः नमो नमो यामुनाय यामुनाय नमो नमः यत्पदाम्भोरुहध्यान विध्वस्ताशेषकल्मषः वस्तुतामुपयातोऽहम् यामुनेयम् नमामि तम्
स्वधर्मज्ञानवैराग्य साध्यभक्त्येकगोचरः नारायणः परम् ब्रह्म गीताशास्त्रे समीरितः
श्रीमान् वेङ्कटनाथार्यः कवितार्किककेसरी वेदान्ताचार्यवर्यो मे सन्निधत्तां सदा हृदि.
A very short and sweet explanation of the fourth chapter's essence in a nutshell at the end of the eighth verse. So, Evam in this way is referred to the 48th paragraph. Now, then Jnanataha. Now, we have been seeing that Karma Yoga is the fundamental and it's a basis or basics to Jnana Yoga. And then from Jnana Yoga, now we come to Bhakti Yoga, slowly reaching the number 13, after 12. But we are in the 4. From the 7th to 12, we have Jnana Yoga. And the link is given even from the 4th chapter to the Jnana Yoga. And there is also a slight reference to Bhakti Yoga in the 4th chapter. Now, referring to the particular verse from Bhagavad Gita today, Bahunam Janmanam Ante Jnanavan Mam Prapadyate. That's a Bhagavad Gita verse which are Lord Krishna's very words. He says, a wise person reaches me or surrenders to me after many births. That means we have undergone lot of births. That is one basic understanding. But today's explanation was very nice from Sri Uve Madhavacharya Swami that we have been undergoing lot either by merits or by sins, lot of births. But this Bahunam Janmanam Ante, after many births, refers to Bahunam Punya Janmanam Ante. Since we have become a human being in this birth, born as a human being in this birth, we are fortunate to read books, understand, get preceptors to advise, and realize on the road to realization of the Lord. And therefore, we are lucky that we had a lot of meritorious births earlier. Not exactly that we have become suddenly a fortunate living being as a human being and today, and we are, yes, Janma Karma Cha Me Divyam. That refers to his birth. Janma Karma Cha Me Divyam is his birth is divine always. He never opposed to divine. But our birth, normally when we say we have undergone a lot of birth, we may think that we have been unlucky so far. We have not realized Lord during the previous birth. This is the only first birth as a human being that we are enjoying the bliss or trying to reach the salvation by understanding the books and falling at the feet of the preceptor. It is not so. We have been, I think, human beings in the previous births also, but we were not able to enjoy fully what we had when we had lot of previous births. Therefore, bahunam punya janmanam ante, meritorious births we had. We were not insects or animals in the previous birth, just to become human being only in this birth. 44th Aryasinghar of Ahobilamat used to say, a human being may be born as a non-trivarnika, or what we call the fourth varna of the, or fourth caste, or fourth division of the human being. And then slowly he must have come up, he must have progressed. And if one has lot of realization during his birth as a human being, but as a non-trivarnika, out of these three varnas, namely Dvija, Kshatriya and Vaishya, then he can directly come to the Dvija clan family, namely the twice born family, and then make further progress. That's what 44th Aryasinghar used to say. But here he can have a good jump from the lowest division to the highest division. And here we go to this 49, evam jnanataha cha. So the word cha, I told you, the cha has meaning. Cha doesn't mean simply and it has no other significance. Not that it has no other significance, but it has more significance. So jnanataha cha will mean karmataha cha. Please remember that. So evam in this way, so how did we achieve to come to that stage of the discipline of wisdom? We have gone through the discipline of action also. So karmataha, then jnanataha cha. Then we are going to achieve something in this very birth. So ekasmin eva janmani. Class la Zoom meeting la ekasmin eva janmani, in this very birth, in a single birth, there are some great achievements possible. That's what the fourth chapter says. Upaya purti anantara janma pratishedhe. No, let us not wait for another birth to complete our process of surrender, total surrender, karma, jnana, bhakti, yoga. We can complete them, all of them, in one shot. That is what he says. Ekasmin eva janmani. So what are we trying to do? Upaya purti anantara janma pratishedhena. So we have to think that we negate another birth. We don't want another birth to complete what is the process of upaya purti anantaram. Upaya purti meaning finishing the upaya meaning, completing the upaya meaning. We already said when we do karma yoga, when we practice jnana yoga, we must remember that pradhana upaya, namely the main means of attaining the Lord, is Lord himself. Pradhana upaya is Lord Sriman Narayana. Therefore, it is very important upaya, and as well as first upaya. It is first upaya and the last upaya also. No other upaya is necessary, and no other upaya is possible. And again, we understand out of our tradition, namely Sattvika Tyaga, when we deny ourselves that we didn't perform our action. And we say anena atmana katra, he is getting it done through us. So we are only the instruments. Again, please remember, in the Satvika Tyaga itself, he is Pradhana Upaya. So even to perform Satvika Tyaga, even to have a mind to say Satvika Tyaga, Bhagavan Eva Swaniyamya Swarupa Sthiti, etc., will be a responsibility to him. So he only encourages, he only makes us do Satvika Tyaga. He only makes us feel that the actions are not ours and it is only his. And therefore, Upaya Purti will be our complete faith. Yes, he is making us do everything, even Satvika Tyaga. Yes, you are right. I think Keshavdas Swami's messages will be easily understood while you watch the messages. You can read the messages if possible, and so that everyone has access to the message. And the word Purti will be our complete faith that Lord Sriman Narayana is the Upaya. There is no other Upaya possible. I repeat, there is no other Upaya tangible. There is no other Upaya available. And we have complete faith in him after Gopthrutva Varana, after the choice of the protector, we have to depend on him. We are always independent and he is always independent. And therefore, Upaya is the means. In Tamil, Upayam has been understood as trick, a connivance, a plan to thwart something. THWART. In order to do something negative, we use the word Upaya. We never use it in a normal positive sense. Here, in Sanskrit, of course, Upaya is the right means, right method. You would have heard about some of the principles in Taittiriya Upanishad. When you say that you must talk truth, then it should be palatable truth, it should be digestible truth, it should be unalloyed truth, it should be favorite truth. So a lot of conditions are there. In the same way, so Upaya has got a lot of angles. Lord is everything, that's all. So Upaya Purti Anantara Janma. Janma, a birth, will be later to Upaya Purti. Anantara is another one. The English also is same spelling sound. Anantaram is A-N-O-T-H-E-R, another. Anantaram is another. Because both English and Sanskrit languages belong to a single group called Indo-Germanic languages. And Sanskrit is the origin, like Latin and Greek to English. And therefore, but Sanskrit is Latin and Greek to many of us. Upaya Purti Anantaram. So after the completion of the thought of Lord Sriman Narayana as the Upaya, Janma is birth. That means when we feel that next birth only we will get some benefit of salvation, and we will there. Because in this human birth, the 100 years of life are not spent very much usefully, because it, only 15 years are available to us. According to Tondaradi Podiyalvar in his Thirumalai, he says, Veda Noor, Pirayam Nooru, Manishardam Puhuvarenum, Padiyam Urangi Poem, Nindradil Padinayandu, Vedai Adu Palaha Nahum, Pini, Pashi, Moop, Tun, Tunbam, Adalal Piravi Venden, Arangama Nagarulane, he says that. So how do you calculate the spending of 100 years of lifetime, if at all we live for 100 years? பாதியும் உறங்கி போகும் 50 இயர்ஸ் ஆர் கான் டு ஸ்லீப் ஸ்லம்பர் டீப் ஸ்லம்பர் 50 இயர்ஸ் ஃப்ரம் த சைல்ட்ஹுட் டு தி லாஸ்ட் ஏஜ் 50 இயர்ஸ் ஆர் ஸ்பெண்ட் ஓன்லி 50 ஆர் ரிமைனிங் அவுட் ஆஃப் 50 வி ஹாவ் வாட் யூ கால் த ட்ரபிள்ஸ் லைக் டிசீசஸ் ட்ரீட்மெண்ட் டு த டிசீசஸ் தென் சஃபரிங்ஸ் ஆல் நெகட்டிவ் தாட்ஸ் தென் வி ஹாவ் ஹங்கர் and how hunger in the sense every day in today ekadashi and we want to eat a lot and ashramas mutts also provide a lot of food today we had what we call the banana raw banana vegetable then the what we call the pumpkin sambar what we call kolambu as we say in Vaishnava parlance then we had payasam tirukkanna madhu we say the sweet of course there was no vada that's all today otherwise we could take curd rice we take curd rice in the morning as breakfast then we take square meals in the afternoon and then we take upma the what you call in very funny translation as salt flour and then coming to here so a lot of food is taken on ekadashi day that means the hunger pinches our belly when we are supposed to fast even without water a friend was saying to me today how can you be without water that will be dehydrating your body in this summer and then I am not able to pronounce loudly achidram ashvamedham taittiriyopanishad all the pancha suktas and how can I recite without taking something can I not take juice he said so hunger will be so hunger throughout the life hunger 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 so that is so pashi or pini is this is pini pashi moop in the old age all the limbs are getting dilapidated we become decrepit all the sense organs are working not normally but in a low level so moop then we are not able to hear we are not able to see a lady was complaining at her very ripe age I am not able to watch TV, I am not able to read books, then what shall I do? She knows beautifully singing the songs of the Lord, but she had no mind at the ripe age. And therefore, we spend our life as a, what you call, delinquent, as a, what you call, juvenile delinquent, before the sweet age 16. Up to 19 we never spend it a lifetime on thinking of God though we call ourselves brahmachari we are not after brahman we are not running after brahman we are running after many other pleasures in this world till age 19 so what do you call balakam balakah say between 10 and 19 a balaka you can say even 5 from the age 5 to 10 there we are innocent pedai avar oru balakan aagum we are innocent we are not taught anything between the age 5 and 10 though at the age of 7 a dvija has to be initiated into upanayanam and he has to know the mantra spell gayatri and then recite all the vedic parts in sandhya vandanam and all and so on but we all spend time according to our will and pleasure and that is again because of the of course influence or by the decree of fate that one will say we won't say that it is on the advice of God So we are not spending the time usefully, and therefore the whole lifetime goes off, and we think that another birth is necessary for realization. So upaya purti anantara janma pratishedhena. So we have to stop that thinking that another birth will be necessary. Then what do you want to do? Bhagavat praptihi, attaining the God, reaching the Lord. That is what it is being sung here. Giyate is Gitam, so Bhagavad Gita. So in the Bhagavad Gita, the song of the celestial, the Lord Krishna advises Arjuna how to attain him. Bhagavat praptihi giyate. Then you have what Keshavdas Swami gave the quote, Janma Karma Cha Me Divyam. So this is what we call understanding, real understanding or perfect understanding of the God's nature, Swarupam. Swarupam we call it. So Janma Karma Cha Me Divyam. Janma, the birth, we can't call it birth, though according to our understanding, it can call it birth. But it generally it's called incarnation. And in the case of Mahalakshmi, we call it appearance. And even in the case of Lord Shiva, it is only appearance, avirbhavaha. Because it's for a short time, rather shortest time possible. Though in case of Sita and Rukmini, it seems that they lived for a long time on earth. And then, so Janma Karma Cha Me Divyam, I think, can you provide the full verse as you did it just now? The ninth verse of the fourth chapter. Okay. Evam yo vetti tattvataha tyaktva deham punarjanma naiti mam eti sorgyame. Here, that is what it is meant by anantara janma pratishedhena is meant by tyaktva deham punarjanma. Tyaktva punarjanma. Not only tyaktva deham, tyaktva punarjanma. So deham, you know, the body, shariram, tanuhu, vapuhu, and so on. Here, tyaktva punarjanma. As you think of God, perform karma yoga, jnana yoga, and bhakti yoga, and end in prapatti yoga, total surrender, then you have no punarjanma, no rebirth. So, tyaktva punarjanma, giving up the rebirth. Then, Mam yeti so Arjuna. Hey Arjuna. So Saha Mam yeti. He will reach me. Saha he yeti reaches Mam. It's a present tense verb, yeti. So he reaches me. So he reaches me in the sense he reaches Vaikuntha. He comes near me. He enjoys the bliss and thought. Otherwise, There is a difference between the Lord and the individual soul, the supreme soul and the individual soul, namely, Janma Karma is not divyam for him. For the individual soul, neither the birth nor the action are divine. Of course, in one aspect we can call it divine, because he only made us born. Made us be born. And he only created us. He only sustains us. He only dissolves us. Therefore, our Janma is also divine if the individual soul is one with the Supreme Soul. And our actions, when you do Sattvika Tyaga, when you feel sincerely and faithfully that all actions are his actions, and we are only the instruments in the hands of God, then even our actions are also holy. So our actions are also divine. Again, one who must understand. Yaha, yo will be then yaha. Veti, understand. Evam, in this way. Tattvataha, really. Exactly. So when an individual soul clearly understands that all the incarnations of the Lord and all actions of the Lord are divine. Divine in the sense it is beyond imaginations by the individual soul. And they are very wonderful, amazing, surprising. We may not understand all the actions of the Lord. Therefore, they are divine. And so coming to the 49th paragraph, here, Upaya Purti Anantara Janma Pratishedhena Bhagavat Pratihi Giyate Janma Karmacha Medhinga. Now, Ataha, therefore, Eva only, so only therefore, he indeed, meaning he means surely. Now, what is the support? What is the proof you are asking? So to attain the Lord, now some ideas are infused in our mind that through the Karma Yoga we reach the Jnana Yoga stage, and within the single birth we complete our faith in understanding that Lord is the Upaya, Lord is the method of approach. And we never expect another birth to wait for realization. And we understand that his birth is divine, his action is divine. Then we have a support from very great people. So we have a list here. At least four people are there. Four people are taken as examples for very great sages. Paramarishayaha, very great sages, what you call spiritual sages, realized seers, S-E-E-R-S, realized seers, they have got knowledge of Brahman, they are wise, they are jnanis, they are proficient in understanding, and examples are given, prachetasa, Parasharya, Shukha, Shaunaka. So number one, the source is Varuna, God Varuna, the rain God, Varuna. Varuna is called Prachetas. The rain God is called Prachetas. So from Prachetas, Valmiki was born. Ratnakara by name. Ratnakara was born in a kumbha, in a pot of water. So also another sage called Agastya, as you know, the shortest dwarf sage, was also born in Yakumba. The water in the pot is the what we call placenta of the womb in a mother's belly. And therefore, now Prachetas, again the word Prachetas. Now, why should we have the example of these four? So there are some unique qualities of these sages. So Prachetas, the very word Prachetas meaning a man of discerning mind. Chetas is mind, as you know, Chittam in Sanskrit, Tamil, and Chetas in Manas, all these are mind, heart we can say, Hridayam. So Prachetas is a good hearted, an efficient hearted, an efficient minded. Prachetas, that is Lord Varuna. So his son will always be intelligent. So his son also have a good son, namely Valmiki. So Valmiki wrote Ramayana, you know, the first Adi Kavyam. So he's called Adi Kavi, first poet in literature. What you call ornate epics, what you call otherwise court epics. That is the first literature book of Sanskrit, whereas all the other books like scriptures, Puranas, lores, Smritis, Dharma Shastras, we are not categorized as kavyam, because kavyam, a poetry book, will have lot of beauty, whereas all other books have some what we call stark reality, actions of stark reality, whereas here we have beautiful similes, especially similes, and all other embellishments to understand deeply the ideas of the scriptures. Of course, all the books without any exception in Sanskrit aim at four purposes of human life: dharma, artha, kama, and moksha. So with this, so Pratyayatata is Valmiki, so that means Ramayana book. Then Parasharya, Parashara is the Maharishi, and Parashara's son is Parasharya, namely Vyasa. So Veda Vyasa is otherwise called Krishna Dvaipayana, otherwise called Badarayana. All the three names refer to Vyasa. So Veda Vyasa was born to Parashara, therefore called Parasharya. Parasharasya putraha Parasharya. Prachetataha putraha Prachetataha. Dasharatasya putraha Dasharati. In that way. Then his son, Parasharya's son, namely Vyasa's son, Shukacharya, is called, otherwise called parrot in English, Shuka. And he is also called Shuka Brahmam. He is Shuka Brahma. Meaning, when we say Paramarishi, even in the young age, he is a prodigy and he has become what you call a jnani, a wise man to understand God. Shuka and Shaunaka. Shaunaka is another sage whose name is heard in the Mahabharata and Bhagavata, where he is giving discourses. He is capable of delivering discourses. All other people are good writers. Prachaitas, Parasharya and Shuka are writers of books. Shaunaka is an orator of the ideas. And therefore, these four are taken as examples to Paramarshayaha. The meaning, so many other people are there. Adayaha. To be brief, Vedanta Deshika Swami has given his Gitartha Sangraha Raksha, these only four names. And then Prayaha, generally, Tatra Eva, there itself, Nishtam Bhuyasim Adriyante. Now, Tatra Eva meaning, there itself meaning, where, Janma Karmacha Medivyam. So, understanding that the Lord's incarnation or birth, generally called birth by us, he is divine and his actions are divine. So in this idea, Tatra Eva, Nishtam Bhuyasim, there what we call steadfastness. Nishtam is sticking to the guns, we say. Sticking to the guns, Nishtam Bhuyasim. Again and again, in a large measure, Bhuyasim. So all these sages, like the four people, Valmiki, four great people, Vedavyasa, his son Shuka, and then Shaunaka. All these are, they have what you call the firm thought in the mind, and therefore they support Adriyante. Adriyante, they give respect to this idea. That means they give lot of respect to the ideas. What do you mean by dependent? Oh. Nishtha is not here dependent. Nishtha is what we call the discipline of the mind. Nishtha, from the Nishtha only we get the anushthanam. The steadfastness in sticking to a particular idea. They don't waver. They don't stray away from the idea. That is the meaning of Nishtha. the bhuya seam, yeah, resting on, right, grounded, right, grounded or resting on, that's a better, all that's a better synonym. Bhuya seam adriyante, therefore since we have support from great people, we must follow them. That's the meaning. Vedanta Deshika's Gita Sangraha supports Gita Sangraha of Sri Yamunacharya with the help of these four people. As Deshika Swami has gone through all the books of these people, now he is also very strict in following all these four people. And he refers to these people in all his works. Whenever there is an occasion, he doesn't fail to, Swami Deshika does not fail to refer to any of these four. He often quotes Valmiki. Starting with the Paduka Sahasram, the 1008 verses, he says, Prachetasa Prabhutibihi Prathamopagitam Toshyami Rangapati Padukayo Prabhavaha, he says. In the first paddhati, what you call Prastava paddhati, within the 20 verses in the first chapter called paddhati, he says, first songster was Valmiki. Prachetasa Prabhutibihi Prathamopagitam. He did it first. Valmiki did it first. And then now I am doing Stoshyami. I am now praising. I am giving the laurels. I am applauding the poet, applauding the Lord, applauding especially the divine sandals of the feet of divine feet of Ranganatha, Srirangam. Therefore, Prathamopagitam Stoshyami Rangapati Padukayo Prabhava. I'm just eulogizing the greatness of the sandals, divine sandals of the Lord, especially Rama in the form of the Nam Perumal in the Utsava idol in the Sanctum Sanctorum of the Srirangam Temple, Srirangamata. So that is how. So this is the essence of the paragraph, and we have got to see lot of quotes. Vyasa, Parasharya is Vyasa. Vyasa is again the author of 18 Puranas, including Bhagavatam, and the largest compendium, namely Mahabharata. And then Mahabharata contains 1 lakh shlokas plus many prose paragraphs. And Mahabharata is the only book in the whole world which is the largest of the largest, combining 2 other language poems called Odyssey and Iliad. These 2 poems are the longest poems of the world. And combining these 2 poems, the longest poems of the world, Odyssey and Iliad, Iliad. This is Mahabharata is 8 times the combination. Mahabharata is 8 times the combination. And therefore, 1/8 is only the combination, 2 points. 1/8. And here coming to Shuka Brahmam. Shuka Brahma's speciality skill is he was giving the discourse to Parikshit Maharaja, and initially he just showed his childish prank that he did not want to learn from Vyasa, and therefore Vyasa had to call him with affection. And out of the 18,000 shlokas of Srimad Bhagavatam of Vyasa, only one attracted him most. And then he came back to the fold of his own father, Guru. Father is Guru. Guru is teacher. So his father was the teacher. And that is this verse. Barhapedam natavara vapuhu karnayoh karnikaram bibhradvasaha kanaka kapisham vaijayanti incha malam randhran venoho adhara sudhaya purayan gopavrindaihi brindaranyam swapada ramanam pravishat gita kirtihi. This is a very important verse of Srimad Bhagavatam, which attracted Shuka's heart. And he came running to the father, namely Vyasa, and he learned from him all the 18,000 shlokas in a short time. And then he delivered the meaning to Parikshit Maharaja in 7 days. That means they are all great people. The Shuka, and you will find very interesting interludes in any discourse. I also would say, and any speaker would say, any person who conducts, especially online classes, also would say, now you are going to listen to very important point, therefore please carefully listen. These are the words repeated often by the speakers. And otherwise, because we tend to sleep over the lectures, especially long lectures like Mahabharata and so on. Parikshit Maharaja, out of fear of death within the 7 days by the curse of a sage's son, because of the simple mistake that he did, that he adorned a sage's head with a dead snake. And then that was his end. And of course, Parikshit Maharaja became very bold at the end to receive death, to welcome death. Here, so Shaunaka, we are not able to give a lot of proof to Shaunaka, because we are not familiar with him very much. But whereas Shaunaka is otherwise called Pauranika, a discourse giver. He is also an expert in oration, oratorical skill. He is good at oratorical skill. And therefore, every time, whenever the listeners demand an answer to their question, then Shaunaka comes to rescue. That is that. Alvar said, Mailinam Varum Sole. Mailinam Varum Sole. Srirangam has lot of parks, and these parks are now occupied by peacocks. Today we saw in our own apartment 4 peahens. But the problem faced by farmers here is, because it is a national bird and it can't be killed, there will be punishment if it is killed. Therefore, they are scot-free, and they gobble up all the paddy fields, all the grains in the paddy fields. And the farmers now feel a lot of sadness. But in North India, recently, we have what we call a swarm of locusts, vertically. Locust is in a large army-like. They are destroying the fields. And here also, they are destroying the wheat field. Here it is the other way about. But the beauty is, peacock's beauty is in the feather, plumage. And that's called barha. So barha pedam. So a pedam, you can say the top head. The head has been adorned by barha. Barha is what you call peacock feather. Then Natavara Vapuhu. He is very good in dancing. not only dancing, he is very good in acting. He is a very very good actor. Swami Vedanta Deshika says he is a pseudo cowherd. Pseudo cowherd. Kuhana Gopaha is a false cowherd boy. False cowherd boy. A cheating cheeram. Somebody called it butter bandit. That somebody is called Shweta Sundaram from Canada. She called him butter bandit. Rhyming. That's why he's a cheating cheeram. So Natavara Vapuhu. He dances before the mother. He dances before other people so that he gets sympathy over him. He gets their sympathy over him in spite of the mistakes that he commits. Of course, the principle all of you can understand is, already know is, he steals our hearts. He's called Harihi. He's a thief. He steals our hearts without our knowledge, and our hearts will melt like butter. And therefore, the butter, taking away the butter, or we can say even seriously stealing the butter, meaning stealing the butter-like mind. The minds are rather melting like the butter as it is put in the hot oven. So our hearts also should melt in the devotion of the Lord. So Natavara Vapuhu. Then Karnayoho, in the ears, we have what you call Tamil Pichippu. And Pichippu is Tamil version. The Sanskrit word is Karnikara. The word Karnikara, the Karnikara flower has no smell. According to Kalidasa's third canto of Kumara Sambhava, we understand that is Karnikara has no smell. So I say it is Bougainvillea. But it is in different colors, beautiful in colors. Yellow, pink, blue, so many red and so many other colors, crimson, brown, but they have no smell. So he is keeping it in the ears. The blue Karnikara flowers, he says. There's no word blue here. There's no word in Sanskrit for blue. Sanskrit is Neelam. Neelam doesn't mean blue. Neelam means black. So we have black rose, but we don't have black Karnikara. Then Bibhrati. Bibhrati is can join with any, like Karnikaram Bibhrati, then Vasaha Bibhrati. In the words besides it, you can join both. Karnikaram Bibhrati, he is holding, he is wearing, W-E-A-R-I-N-G, wearing the flower in the ears. Then Vasaha Bibhrati, he is wearing a dress, Vasa. Vasa is dress. What kind of dress? Normally we say Pitambaram with regard to Sriman Narayana. Is a yellow silk dress, we say. He is called Pitambara Dhari. But here it is in another way. The yellow color is of the gold color. So Kanaka is gold. Kapisham is tawny brown. T-A-W-N-Y. Tawny brown. Kanaka Kapisham. So again, Bibhrati Kanaka Kapisham Vasaha. So he wears the dress with the color of gold, tiny and tawny brown. It's what you call mix up of colors. Recently, Shanta Madam will definitely remember that there was a sari with 50,000 colors. 50,000 colors. And many women went for it. I don't know whether they can still keep it intact and wear it. 50,000 colors. So, okay, this is I think two color. So double color. we have normally, you know, as we say, because women are fond of this colors in their dress, and we call mail kalt. Mail kalt is what we call peacock's neck. Today also, when I saw peahens, the peahens also had a very beautiful neck, colorful neck. Though they don't have plumage, they have colorful necks. And that mail kalt will have two shades of the colors. Two shades of the colors. When you tilt the dress, tilt the cloth, then you will have another color. So then, Vaijayanti incha mala. Vaijayanti is a garland. And it has a small background. When a Rakshasa demon came to attack Arjuna, he was called Dhumra. Dhumra the demon. When he attacked Arjuna, Lord Krishna had to intervene and save him. So Lord Krishna received the, what you call, the weapon on his chest. It's called Bhalla, Bhalla. It's what you call, as you now understand, with a lot of spikes. We call, I think, you say, what you call, the Mullampandri in English, Mullampandri. The pig-like animal which has got a lot of spikes.
Porcupine.
Porcupine, yeah. The porcupine is a eating item by many. Porcupine is a type of the weapon. The balla is a porcupine type of weapon. And it was sent to Arjuna's chest, and Lord Krishna received it. And Lord, when he received it, it became Vaijayanti mala. So Vaijayanti incha malam. So he has a winning garland, a garland for winning. Please remember Ramayana story where Sugriva was asked to go and fight with his elder brother Vali in the first instance. And then he was punished further by that, what you call, by that action. And then secondly, he was asked to have a garland. And then by which the, what you call, the monkey leaders could be identified easily by Rama. And therefore, Vali had to be killed. Otherwise, Rama only played with him to say that because he, Sugriva that did some mistakes. Even after the death of Vali, Sugriva committed a mistake of delaying the search of Sita. Lakshmana had to threaten him, and therefore Sugriva was given punishment. So he had a garland later, and then because of the difference in garland wearing, Sugriva and Vali not wearing the garland, Rama identified Vali. Now, this is by the way. So, Vaijayanti incha mala. Randhran. Now, he is an expert in flute. Singing by flute. And therefore, Randhran meaning the holes, H-O-L-E-S, the holes, Randhran, Venu is the, what you call, the bamboo. Bamboo is called Venu. So the Venoho, so Venu Gopalaha we say. So Venoho, Adhara Sudhaya, the music, the tune that comes out of the holes of the flute are sweet. The tunes are sweet because his lips are sweet. His lips are sweet. Adhara, the lower lip. In Sanskrit, there are two words for lips. One for upper lip and the one for lower lip. The upper lip is called Oshtaha, whereas the lower lip is called Adhara. Adharaha, Adaha meaning down. Adharaha means lower lip. Now generally, sometimes generally the lower lip will be a little bigger in size than the upper lip. That will be what we call Samudrika Lakshanam, the beauty of figure. Then the definition of the beauty. Then Adhara Sudhaya, Sudha was there, Amrutam was there, Nectar was there. Adhara Sudhaya. So he was filling the holes with sweetness. By the what you call, you can even say saliva of the tongue or of the lips, the what you call the drenched lips, the wet lips. The wet lips also filled the fruit with fruit hole with sweetness. So Adhara Sudhaya, Purayan is filling. Then Gopavrindaihi. He was also filling up the forest with flute music, sweet flute music. And he was also filling up the forest with the herds of cowherd. The herds of cowherd, Gopa Vrindaihi. They were calmly listening. So Gopa Vrindaihi, Vrindaranyam. Vrindaranyam or Vrindaranyam, same. So Vrindaranyam, Aranyam forest. Vrindaranyam is what you call thick forest. Lot of bushes are there. Even if you go to Mathura today, Vrindavan, you find lot of bushes. The trees are very close to each other. So Vrindaranyam. And how was it sweet? Made sweet. Swapada Ramanam. The forest also felt the sweetness of the Lord's feet, Swapada. So he stamped on the forest, rather Vrindavanam. And therefore, what happened to the Lord Krishna? Pravishat, he entered into that forest. Pravishat. Then Gita Kirtihi. Lord Krishna has been very famous, popular, even before his birth. Why even before his birth? Because Kamsa, the uncle, had the fear shivering in his bones that the eighth child of his sister Devaki would be born to kill him. And therefore, Lord Krishna's birth has been already predicted by the Ashariri, by the aerial voice. Ashariri Swaram, what you call an anonymous voice from the sky to make him get bad sleep. And therefore, so Pravishati, he entered into the forest, namely Vrindavan. Gita Kirtihi, his praise was sung earlier. It was popular. He is what you call. He has got Jayamana Kataksha. Even in the very birth, he has been lucky with a lot of skills. And before going to the paragraph 49, I want to tell you that Vedanta Deshika enjoys his childhood in Gopala Vimshati with just 21 verses. I refer to only one here because to make you feel the happiness of enjoying the childhood of Krishna. He plays flute. Lord Krishna plays flute. When you take the Periyarvar Pashuram, Periyarvar is Vishnu Chitta. Vishnu Chitta's Pashuram, the poem is 443 strong. 443 strong. Starting with Tirupallandu. So he blessed blessed the Lord as his child. And he says, when Lord Krishna's flute music is heard, all the fauna in the forest remain still to hear him. even the birds paravin kanangal koodu turandu padukaadu kidappa karavin kanangal kaal parappittu cheviyaattakillave. A very beautiful description when Lord Krishna was playing the flute. Kannan kudal kodu oodiya podu. Kannan kudal kodu oodiya podu. So what happened? The birds, the flock of birds, came out of their nest and remained silent, watching and hearing the flute music. Whereas the cattle, cows especially, they sat on the ground, directed their ears to the listening to the music of the flute, and they didn't move a little. They didn't move their ears. They just squatted on the ground. Kaal parappittu ennan cheviyaattakillave. And again, I want to tell you just one verse from Andal Goda Devi in her 173 songs, called in two sections, Nachiyar Thirumozhi and Thirupavai. She said, Karpuram Narumo Kamalappu Narumo Shambavala Shavvaidan Thitthi Thirukkumo Chollari Ven Shange. She called the conch, Panchajanyam, and said, please tell me, O conch, that what is the sweetness, how is the sweetness of the lips of Lord? It will be better than Karpuram Narumo. The smell will be better than the camphor. Then camphor will have a bad smell, because the smell of the Lord through the mouth or out of the flute, coming out of the flute, will be defeating the good smell of the camphor. Karpuram Narumo, Kamalappu Narumo, even the lotus smell will be the fragrant filaments of lotus flower will have less smell, less good smell, whereas his lips will have, because Panchajanyam, the conch, is enjoying the sweetness of the lips. Kamalappu Narumo Shambavala Shavvaidan Thittithirukkumo. His mouth is like a coral, as red as a coral gem. And therefore, from that mouth, beautiful mouth, what is the sweetness that you enjoy? Please tell me. She is addressing the conch. And Vedanta Deshika says beautifully, Anuyayi Manogya Vamshanalaihi Avatusparshita Vallavi Vimogaihi Anaghasmita Sheetalaihi Asaumam Anukampa Saridambujai Rapangaihi. A very beautiful scientific principle has been brought out here. The child, Lord Krishna, is singing with his flute, and the bhaktas, the devotees, especially cowherds and cowherdesses first, and then cowherds, all the people in the Gokulam, the cow pen, are listening to his flute music, and they are also expecting that Lord Krishna should show himself in the real form, what you call tangible physical frame. And therefore, when they want to see, they want to have a vision of the Lord, divine vision of the Lord, the light from their eyes, from the devotee's eyes, reaches the Lord's form so quickly, so quicker than the music, flute music, is being heard by them. And therefore it overtakes. The time taken by the flute music to reach them is overtaken by the vision, or rather we can say the kataksha, the oblique vision from the corners of the eyes from the Lord to reach the devotee. So he said anuyayi manogya vamsha nalaihi. Vamsham is another word for venu. Vamshaha is another word for venu. Vamsha is what you call bamboo. So today the situation is different, but generally we say that joint family is good. Generally the principle of joint family is good, but today we have become so selfish that we now call husband and wife as a nuclear family without children nearby. And therefore what I want to say is here, vamsha, why vamsha is given the name to bamboo. All the bamboo trees are growing in a cluster. They are always growing in a cluster. It is like a single joint family of many members. And therefore, elders bless the youngsters. All pol tharaitthu, arugubol verodi. Then vamshavali will be what you call the generation. Vamsha is generation. Vamsha is bamboo. The generation should be like bamboo. A bamboo cluster. Meaning all siblings, brothers and sisters will stay together, will enjoy each other's company in a family along with the parents and grandparents and so on. So here that is the word for used for blessing. Vamsha. Vamsham vilangattum vise. Next progeny will be continued, and that is the blessing that that we get. So we don't use the word venu in that case. We use the word vamsha. So anuyayi vamsha naalaihi naadaihi. The music of the flute comes out naadaihi. Avatu that it comes behind. It lags behind. The music of the flute comes behind the light. The light in from the vision. So the light is faster than sound. That is the physics principle that we understand. We always measure the distance between the planets as light years. Light years. And therefore, here we have what we call anuyayi manogya vamshanalaihi. Avatu. Let the music flute and the vision of the Lord protect us. Avatu. Avatu sparshita vallavi vimoghaihi. So all the cowherders are confused over, or rather attracted towards the music, and they want to have the vision of the Lord quickly. Vimoghaihi. Anaghaspita shitale rasoma. The beauty in the Lord is his smile is bewitching. His smile is bewitching. He has no bad smile. He has got a beautiful smile. It's a what you call faultless smile, blemishless smile. We call it mandahasa in Sanskrit also, gentle smile. And this is like the smile of goddess Sita in Ashokavana when she addressed Ravana. How to smile at another man in a society by a woman. The woman should always can have smile at other men, but how should be the smile? The smile should be pure smile. Anaghasmita, pure smile. Sita had a pure smile towards Ravana. Ravana had a cheating smile on Sita. He had a cunning smile on Sita. Rather, what you call pratarana. Pratarana means cheating. Here, anaghasmita, and because of the smile, Lord Krishna smile during his playing on the flute, that becomes more and more attractive. Anaghasmita shitalaihi. Also, the cool smile. The smile is cool also. We also today advise when somebody gets angry, cool down. So shitalaihi, anagaspita shitalaihi, asau mam, Anukampa. So what will be the type of vision? Anukampa. Anukampa is compassion. So what you call filial compassion, affectionate compassion. So like Anukampa Sarit, it will be flowing like a river from the eyes of the Lord, the divine eyes of the Lord. So Anukampa Sarit Ampujaihi Apangaihi. It is a lotus-like eyes. It is what we call lotus-like eyes, flowing with a lot of affection, like a river of affection. And then finally, what happens is the vision reaches the devotee first, and the flute music is heard next. So that is the beauty of Vedanta Deshika's description over the flute music. I am just quoting only one or two, so that you will understand the beauty here and there. So over to.
So I just wanted to say one other thing. I looked at Vamsha in Monty Williams' dictionary, and it describes that it is a genealogy or a pedigree, a dynasty, just like the bamboo has many joints coming after each other. One piece of bamboo has got many joints coming one after another, parampara. So.
And you can compare it to a banana tree also. The banana tree is also grow in cluster. But from the bottom of the banana main tree, mother tree, the children also grow along with the. That is why both are used for the bamboo and the banana are the examples for blessing the children, youngsters. And we say, Vaayadi Vaayai, the generations should continue. Vaayadi Vaayai. The banana under the banana. The young tree, under the main tree. You know. Now, of course, only taken as analogy, should not be, the comparison should not be very deep, because the banana gives birth to only one, rather a big child, what you call a bunch of banana fruits. Then it has to end its life. And whenever you cut the leaves of banana, you must cut the leaves of the younger trees than the main tree, so that they will grow again and again. They will give you a lot of leaves, not the main leaf. But Vamsha is used for blessing because the family should be a joint family. They always grow in clusters, bushes, only bamboo bush with it. We never say bamboo tree, bamboo bush.
Yeah, but I joined just at the time, the most important time where you were glorifying Prapatti as the only means. The absolute only means. And you know, I like that because I love the word prapanna. You know, so I feel very happy that you say it's the only means. I just wanted to find out why it is that the Varakalai school still says bhakti yoga also is one of the paths, if it is that you glorified it as the only path to actually attain God in this age, or in all ages, that is.
And again, I just tell you this idea which I broached today in the beginning of the session, that in the total surrender and in Sattvika Tyaga, we must remember very strongly that Lord Shiva Narayana is the greatest one and only one single. And the best or very important upaya, that is the exact thinking that we must have while we make a total surrender. And in the process of sarvadharman parityajya, while we are giving up the fruit of the actions involved, we are not expecting any fruits like moksha. Even moksha is not the result of prapatti. the only the preeti of the Lord is the affection of the Lord is the aim, the goal, and again the prapatti, the prapatti also is not the means to attain moksha. The total surrender is not the means to attain moksha. Only means is Lord. You don't adopt prapatti to say, oh, I am adopting prapatti to reach Lord. No.
Good. Great. So then basically that's it. The Lord is Dhyopaya, and that's the main thing, and He is Dhyopaya. And that's all we need to know, and that's all we need to remember. That's the conclusion of everything. You go ahead, Mataji.
Okay, so that's why I think you told me. Okay, sorry, 1 minute. That's why in your previous lecture you said in the Vishnu Sahasranam also we don't say Palashruti.
Ah.
Yeah, that's one of the reasons you said. Yeah.
No, yes. See, Palatyaga, Sarvadharman Parityajya will have Palatyaga. Okay, you have to perform action, but you don't worry about the fruit. Karmanyeva adhikarate ma phaleshu kadachana. Ma karma, ma te sangostu akarmani. Ma karma phala hetur buhu ma te sangostu akarmani. That is there. But even in while what we call, while we give up the fruits of action, the very action of giving up the fruits of action is also not yours. You are not giving up. It is He who has given up your actions. Or rather, your fruits of action. Okay. Now, yes, Govinda has done so again. And I before I forget, I will give you an assignment. I'm sending my friends, a very young friends, horoscope. I think it is in English. I think you need not.
All we need is the date and time of birth and place of birth.
He is almost 19 years old. 19 years old. And he has a problem of passing examinations and then passing out BA English. So the mother wants me to consult somebody to find out a remedy.
But Swami, you have so many wonderful, far, far knowledgeable, greater astrologers in Srirangam. Why me?
I'm throwing this assignment to everyone.
Okay, you're gonna throw it. Okay. So the only other thing I wanted to ask is there seem to be many, many variations in the Sri Vaishnava world, both sampradayas, etc., with respect to diet and Ekadashi. Of course, Ekadashi means that one shouldn't have anything at all, even water. Today is Nirjala Ekadashi here in the UK.
Yeah.
But then if one cannot do that, especially if one doesn't look for any benefit of Ekadashi, but one doesn't want to commit any papam, you know, try not to commit any papam, really, what is the acceptable standard? Because some say one can take broken rice, some say one cannot take. I've read, you know, both from Tengalai school and Deshika Sampradaya schools, they're giving different ideas. Even though I've heard that Chinnajir school, they have broken rice, etc. in Ekadashi. I was reading what he has to say, and he says no grains whatsoever, which includes beans, etc. So what's the actual standard? In the past, you said you were going to provide a pramana from a pastambha regarding that broken rice is allowed. So just wanted to get that correct, because it's just good to have a pramana, you know, if anyone asks with respect to that.
I recently came across the pramana. I shall pass it on to you.
Excellent.
But again, our exclusively the Sri Vaishnava Sampradaya, whether it is Tengalai or Deshika, we have a contention. Rather, the Tenacharya Sampradaya does not worry about the seriousness of the fasting. That's what I understand. I am subject to correction. But Vadagalai Sampradaya, the Deshika Sampradaya, has a very categorical definition that we are not supposed to take normal rice food during Ekadashi day. Sometimes what you call is the previous day becomes what you call Advaita in the Ekadashi, Advaita Sampradaya Ekadashi. Second day we Vaishnava Ekadashi. So we have got lot of names given to this Ekadashi. Kaishika Ekadashi, Vaikuntha Ekadashi, so many other, this time as you said, Nirjala Ekadashi. All are Nirjala Ekadashi without any distinction. We have to give rest to the stomach. And it's because it's 24 hours working like an industry, like an important industry. And therefore, the giving rest to the industry, the stomach will be beneficial to our health. And even I felt even for diabetics, it will be good. Fasting will be good for diabetics also. The diabetics also are always advised to have, instead of two meals a day, five times or six times something to eat and so on. And they may feel weak. And then again, there are two types of diabetics, low sugar and high sugar. So I felt that diabetics also will have benefit by fasting. Suppose in your age or Keshavadas Swami or even madam, if you can bear with hunger for 24 hours, then of course, not filling up our stomach the earlier night on Dashami day, Dashami night we just full. I mean, we say in Tamil and yeah, rice part of it, particle should come out of his nose. Till that we will have to fill up our stomach. And there is also one more incident, we say, the teacher, the guru, wanted the shishya to find out whether he wears chappals, if he wears sandals, shoes, because he couldn't bend. His belly is so big as a pot, and then he wanted the disciple to look at his feet and whether he has already wears shoes. And then the disciple said, sir, I searched all over and I see only stars. He had his full. And then he could not even bend down. He could not even see in the normal direction. He had to lift up his face up. He only sees the sky. Therefore, we become gluttons on Ekadashi day. That is the problem with us.
When we have to worry about fasting, we end up eating more. So, you know, when we have to think, oh, we are restricted, we end up eating more because we feel that, you know, if we don't eat, we may faint. Yeah. But
our thinking of food makes us hungry. And therefore, yes. I always tell people, follow Vaishnava Sampradaya, take the advised items and advisable items, and then remember the God's name more on Ekadashi.
Yes.
Of course, daily 24/7, we are supposed to remember Him. But if we are not able to remember Him on your errands and work pressure and so on, at least remember on Ekadashi day one day. And just like Lord Krishna, Lord Sriman Narayana has allotted exclusively a month called December-January, December 14th to January 14th, to avoid all functions like marriage, Upanayanam, the sacred ceremony, except the birthday. No other function should be arranged during the December 14th to January 14th, Dhanurmasa. That is the reason being that is the earliest time of mourning of the gods, and therefore we have to be very careful in worshipping them. That is why that month has been selected. And one or two months are avoided even for begetting children, so that the delivery will be in full month.
Sure, do you have a full picture?
Thank you. I'll please don't forget us with that pramana. We really, really want to look for that. We want to see that pramana. So if you can, please share it with us. Thank you very much.
Swami, in terms of Ekadasi, and I also have a pramana that you are supposed to take whatever a Brahmin tells you you can take. So that this is perhaps why we have so many different messages from different people, because each person was giving some advice, and everybody is an individual, so different advices are given to different people.
There are two lower and upper limits for observing Ekadashi: age 5 and age 85, if not possible. Only if not possible. So between 5 and 85, you have to follow. And in my family, in our family, we have the practice of taking the wheat, broken wheat. And as children, we never objected to it, because the whole 14 days, all the 14 days, we are taking the rice food. And a change will be there for on Ekadashi day, so that we take wheat, broken wheat. Then we have all other items as usual. But later on, I advised my own family members, please avoid vegetables also. Try to avoid something which you feel that they are very, nutritious. The nutritious items, please avoid on Ekadashi day. Especially vegetables. When you don't have vegetables, you have no inclination to eat the food, take the food off. If you have side dishes, you consume more. If you don't have side dishes, then that's why I also advise myself not to take prayams, fried side dishes are very attractive, tasty, and therefore you will avoid on Ekadashi.
Bakshanam,
not only bakshanam, vadam. It's a favorite for all. The puppet also, appalam is also favorite for all. So avoid those specific items, so that you will hate food on that particular day.
So no appalam, even in the payasam, no appalam.
Yeah.
Like your father. Okay.
The danger is that we might end up hating the day also.
Okay. So
any feedback from Madam Malini? She has been a silent observer all these days. And,
yes, Swamiji. It is like, this is like prasadam for my soul. Yeah. Our tea in Trinidad.
Yeah.
So I'm really enjoying your sessions, but it is like I said, really like a nice shower for my soul. So very nice.
And thank you for the idea. Some people make a lame excuse that Antaryami Lord, their Sriman Narayana is in a hot and he has to be fed. He will remain hungry. And therefore, Ekadashi, also we can consume something.
Yes.
Swami, when we start eating, we have to do Pranagnihotram.
Yeah.
So we are offering to the Lord in the heart.
Yeah. When we fast.
So Pranagnihotram is a Nitya Homa.
Yeah. Okay. And with regard to offering of the food on Ekadashi day to Lord by Tiruvaradhanam, by the Aradhanam, many people say that he has to be given all the usual items. Fruits can be offered in lieu of rice food and so on. Many fruits can be offered. And again, on the next day, Dwadashi, because we fast, in order to prevent the formation of ulcer in the stomach, we will have what we call ahati kirai, the green leaves, the myrobalan, the
amalaki,
amla fruit. And on the
pachadi. They make a pachadi.
And also tamarind-less rasam. Rasam without tamarind.
On Dwadashi, yes.
On Dwadashi. I think all of us know that. Because intake of tamarind increases the ulcer. If at all.
Okay. So you were mentioning that people take a lot of food on the night before Ekadasi, on the Dwadasi night. But in some shastras it says you have to fast on the Dwadasi night also. And you have to fast on the Dasami night also.
Fast on Dasami night. That is very important. But not on Dwadasi night.
I can show you some pramanas for that also. They say you have to give up 4 times eating.
Oh, that is not, and only when, and that occurs only on the occasion of Shravana Dwadashi. Shravana Nakshatra occurs on Dwadashi day. So you have to fast on both days, Ekadashi and Dwadashi. That's a little more difficult.
Mahadwarasi, Shravana Mahadwarasi. Yes, so that is more difficult.
Not Maha and Dwadashi.
Okay, so we can discuss this more another. Can I bring us back to the today's lecture? I wanted to make some observations.
Yeah.
Okay, so
you can also be brief.
I'll be brief. Okay, so you were saying about Janma Karma Chame Divyam, Bhagavad Gita 4.9 was being quoted, and you were saying that the Lord's appearance and activities, they are completely divine, they're completely spiritual. But if we think that the Lord is working through us, then our activities are also spiritual and completely divine. And so I thought that was very, very interesting observation. I was wondering why particularly these four rishis were being chosen by Vedanta Deshika, because there are so many others, and he has been very careful to say Prachedas and Parasarya, to give the names of Valmiki and the names of Vyasa in such a way as to also glorify their fathers. So and also this Valmiki, I'm trying to understand. In the beginning, he was a bad man. He was a dacoit. So how is it that because he was the son of the rain god, he became a dacoit?
You mean he was a tribal, scheduled tribal. Well, he was a hunter.
Yeah, but he was also killing people. He was...
That's right. He was a hunter. He was a robber. He was called Ratnakara. And of course, his birth was divine. Like Ravana was the son of a great sage, Vishravas. He is called Vaishravana. But here the example is good example. A bad son becoming a good son. They are getting improved as a good son. Because after Narada's advice, he realized that the sins committed by him to rob and make a livelihood of his family. The family members refused to have a share of the sins. Then he realized that he must meditate on Lord. And then when he was meditating, the ant hill developed on him. And later on, he was called Valmiki. Valmikam is an ant hill, out of which he came out, and therefore he is the son of ant hill. Valmiki.
Right.
But generally, many people's background or biography will be from the bad to the good. Tondaradi Pudi Alvar, Bhaktangri Renu.
Yes.
Of course, we
know that story. Yeah.
Yeah. Therefore, so many people. Vyasa, we used to say when there was a discussion on reservation, what you call arakshanam in Sanskrit, is referred to in many angles. Reservation of the travel, reservation by the caste in government jobs, especially in India. I gave the topic, and many people gave poems on reservation. I said in the first verse, Valmiki is a scheduled tribe. Vyasa is a fisherman. A fisherman's daughter's son. Therefore, both of them are backward caste, as you said, from low caste. But they have become great people. And why this choice of, now coming to your question of why this choice of, I didn't tell you earlier, many people cannot study scriptures. Therefore, their handicap is filled up by reading Ramayana, Mahabharata, Bhagavata. Instead of even reading Bhagavata, you remember just hearing Bhagavan Shuka. And then Shaunaka's explanation in all the Puranas. So all this refer to the easy approach of the Vedic ideas. Therefore, these four are chosen. Otherwise,
if
you say it's Apastamba Maharishi, and then Vasishtha's yoga Vasishtam, and then so many other smritis like Yajnavalkya Smriti, then people may not understand. Common people may not understand.
Yeah, but
Bhagavad Gita is so difficult a text. When it needs explanation, easy text will be recommended through stories.
Right. So people who are not dwijas and people sudras and ladies, they cannot read the Shruti, they cannot read the Vedas, the Upanishads. So That's why he's picked all these four, because they've given easy shastras for everybody to read. Okay, very good. Okay, so
that you asked.
Okay. I also didn't know this story about Agastya. I know that Agastya is very famous in South India because he's giving Tamil. He's explaining, he's the progenitor of Tamil, no? Tamil language.
Yeah.
And also he has to do with the mountains in South India have something to do with Agastya. And so, yeah. But I didn't know he's born of a Kumbha. He's born from a Kumbha.
Called so Kumbha Muni.
Kumbha Muni.
His very name is Kumbha Muni. Even Valmiki, the Varuna, god of rain, is not called Kumbha Jata. Whereas Kumbha Muni is a famous name for Agastya. And again, Agastya had many beautiful incidents in his life. He balanced the earth when Lord Shiva got married in Kailasa. The whole ground was tilting. Therefore, Agastya went to the south. In Parashurama Kshetra, Kerala, and then he remained there just pushing by the weight down to balance the earth, you say. Because all people, lot of people, all gods attended the wedding of Lord Shiva and Parvati. And again, as you said, he never allowed the Meru mountain to grow further. Some of them are his achievements.
So,
Agastya Purana.
So Meru was growing.
Yeah, in size.
So he stopped it.
Stopped the growth of the mountain. And that is because, again, that will hamper the heaven if it grows so high.
I see.
As Indra requested Agastya to stop it from growing.
Hmm. So I also
and Agastya is a sage out of his out of whose stomach two rakshasas could not come out.
Yes.
Ilvala and Vatapi.
Yeah.
Vatapi and Ilvala. They were killing all sages like that. Ilvala, yes. Ilvala was cooking Vatapi. Vatapi is a human flesh.
Yes.
Because all the sages had
flesh-eating
habit.
Yes, we know that story. There's a place in Karnataka called Vadami where that happened. And Vatapi was turning into a goat and being killed by his brother and being cooked. And then it was offered to the guest, and the guest would eat it. Then he would become alive again and burst out from the stomach and kill the person. And then the rakshasas would eat that person. So this is their motive every day. They would do this, but Agastya digested them. So he was unable to kill him. So yeah, it's
an Vatapech Jirno Bhava.
Jirno Bhava, okay. Okay, very good story. Okay, so we also enjoyed very much your explanation of Bhagavatam, 10th canto, 21st chapter, 5th verse, about Lord Krishna and the flute and his peacock for everything. And also of Andal's Tirubai Moli, Nachiya Tirubai Tirumoli, and also Gopala Vimsati by Vedanta Deshika. All those things I've given links to people to find. Can you tell, you said you use the word Bhoga Mila. What does it mean, Bhoga Mila?
Okay.
Bhoga Mila. Bhoga Mila.
Okay. Can you message it?
Yeah. Okay. Bhoga Mila. It's okay. I also never heard this. This story about the porcupine weapon. This porcupine weapon story was very interesting. That porcupine weapon turned into Vajanti Mala.
Yeah.
Yeah. Where is that story from? Mahabharata?
From Bhagavatam.
Bhagavatam. Oh, okay. I'll look in Bhagavatam, but maybe if you know the exact place, you can tell me. Also, I wanted to ask that you said Vrindaranya means a thick forest. Vrindaranya. But Vrinda also means Tulasi, no?
Vrinda also means?
Vrinda means Tulasi. Also. Tulasi. Tulsi. Tulasi. Oops, sorry.
I didn't understand the word Bogamela. Tulasi, oh. Brinda, of course, Brinda means Tulasi, but here the Brinda meaning group.
I see.
It's a host, H-O-S-T. And Brinda in Sanskrit is a neuter gender word. And therefore, we say that all were silent and were listening to the flute music. Brindavanam is what we call Brinda Avanam. Brinda is the crowd. Avanam is protection. Protection of the crowd. Protection of the cowherd crowd. There are so many other meanings also.
Okay, nice. Okay, so again on that point about all of our activities are also divine because the Lord is working through us. But that means we don't have any actions. We don't actually have any actions. All actions are His. So all actions are divine.
Yeah.
So, okay.
I gave you the other angle also.
Yeah. Yeah. And you mentioned that we don't say the Palashruti and Vishnu Sahasranama. But personally, I'm saying the Palashruti and Vishnu Sahasranama, but I'm attributing all the Pala to Him. So, because I know, I see Sri Vaishnavas there also chanting the Palashruti of Vishnu Sahasranama. So,
Madam refers, Nanda Madam refers to is Satvika Tyaga, we give up Palashruti.
Yes, we give up the Pala, yes.
Otherwise, she was referring mildly to this Satvika Tyaga.
Right.
And even though you say this Shruti, Pala Shruti, we say it for saying.
Yes. So.
And Pala Shruti is not very seriously taken, seriously considered.
Can I ask one more thing, Swami?
Yeah,
we use the porcupine quill in rituals like Simanta, etc. Why is it that it's used? What's the significance of porcupine quill?
There are two mantras governing these two actions in the what you call Simanta. It's called not Simanta, it is Simanta. Is the borderline of the hair in the center of the head. It is not by fashion, they have it in the sides. They are not supposed to have the side borderline. So this borderline is a very important part of the head where you know there is a rantra hole in your top by which you received food from your mother in the womb, not only from the umbilical cord, not only through the umbilical cord, but also from that. And that is also the way from which the Sushumna Nadi gets out with at the end of the life. What is the Nadi? I think Kaivasudas Swami can help. The life ebbing out of the body through this hole on the top.
Yes.
For a yogi.
Sahasradhara chakra, no?
Chakra, but beyond that, then special nadi, the name of the nadi is there. And then.
Right. Brahmarandra. Brahmarandra.
Randra is hole. So in the parting line of the hair, you use the porcupine, not porcupine's quill, right? The sharpness, of course, the sharpness of the quill gives some what you call radiation. I think you have understood the what you call the hairs standing on end. There's a horripilation. That horripilation the another action, namely squeezing the banyan tree bud. Have you not heard that? That the banyan tree bud is squeezed on the nose.
Yes, this is Pumsavanam, isn't it?
Yeah, Pumsavanam. Both Pumsavanam and Simanta.
Oh, okay.
I think it's a combined. Nowadays, it's a combined ceremony in Sri Vaishnava society.
Yeah, Pumsavana Simanton Nayana Utsavaha. The festival involving both Pumsavanam, Pumsavanam. Savanam is Yaga, the sacrifice. Pum is to beget a male child, male progeny. And then Simanta, Sima is the border. Sima is the border of the line in the head. And when these two are applied, the safe delivery is assured. No cesarean.
But this is what the debating is, that, but why porcupine quill? Is it some kind of, it has some kind of magic protection? I know it's supposed to be a quill with three white spots on it. But why is that? Is it that it has some kind of spiritual benefit? We're seeing here now with, it's become Vaijanti Mala on Krishna's neck when it was thrown at him as a weapon. But any reason why that particular thing?
But the weapon is not made of porcupine quills. The weapon is compared to a porcupine. The weapon is made of steel. The weapon is made of iron, but it's spikes, many spikes.
Okay.
Just like if we have a grenade, sometimes people think the grenade looks like a pineapple, but it's not made of pineapple. It looks like a pineapple because it has segments.
Right.
So this weapon looks like a porcupine. So it's called porcupine weapon, but it's actually made of iron. It's actually made of sharp iron metal needles.
Okay, yes. Like that ball that they throw. Okay.
Yeah,
but
so you're taking things too literally. You're taking things too literally.
Yeah. But still, we use porcupine quill for Simanta. So yeah, I mean, why a porcupine quill? Anybody knows?
I don't know. I think you're correct, Govindachari. We use it. I don't know why. Yes, we use porcupine quill.
Yeah.
That's what I said. The horripilation it creates. What do you say? Some other word.
When we're putting it through, put it through the path, it causes that.
Sanskrit is called pulakam kitam. The first time when the girl becomes comes into the family way, she becomes ancient. She has a lot of fears over delivery. We say prasava vairagyam is in Sanskrit. Prasava vairagyam. After the birth of the first child, the woman takes a decision, a final decision, not to give birth to the next child. Because so much painful is the delivery. That is prasava vairagyam. Smashana vairagyam is when you see people dying and going to the graveyard, the burial ground, and the cremation ground. Then you decide, then you must have no next birth. Because the smashana vairagya. You have detachment towards birth again, rebirth.
Yeah. Some last thing, so
in Simanta, the horripilation created, pulakankitam created, I give you the word thrill. The thrill of becoming a pregnant woman and the thrill of delivering a child and enjoying the child's prank after the birth, after the delivery. And today is It's as easy as a cakewalk in American hospital, especially. Though Americans do not have a heavy population, the delivery is very easy compared to other countries. Meaning the medical facilities are so good that you would like to have one more child because of the treatment, good treatment given by the hospital. So here the problem was life and death problem for the first delivery. It is like the first heart attack. If you escape the first heart attack, you can escape many heart attacks. That's the
last thing. The Brahmarandra is where we keep the shikha, or is it at the very top of the head here, where you're touching here, or is it here?
Not just before the shikha.
Shikha.
Unless you have a purva shikha. If you have a purva shikha, then it's on the Brahmarandra. If you have a adhara shikha, then you have it in off the Brahmarandra. But the Brahmarandra also is a hole, and it closes also after the baby. It's very soft in the babies.
That's soft. Even now it is soft. It is not as soft as when you are a child, but a little thick growth of the skin is there now.
Because that's why my understanding is that the shikha is there to cover that part, that Brahmarandra, because it's supposed to be. That's one of the reasons that the shikha is there, because that part of the head is so tender. So you don't shave that part and leave it exposed also.
No, there's no, rather what you call, harm in exposing the male top of the head for males. Only for women, the whole head is covered with hair.
Thanks very much, Swami.
The front portion of the head for men is supposed to be exposed to the sunlight, and the back side, where we say brain is there, it's called Mukulam in Sanskrit. Mukulam. The whole part must be covered with heavy hair, so that you don't need helmet when you fall. It protects you. And it should not be exposed to sunlight also. Lot of heat should not affect the brain. That's our understanding.
Thank you very much, Swami.
No doctor, what they call neurologist, can understand the working of the human brain. And they say they guess something. If the right side of the brain is affected, the patient has left side affected in the limbs. And if the left side of the brain is affected, some article, blood clot is there, not good flow of blood. The right side of the limbs are affected. But there is no proof. There is no proof. The doctor does brain surgery.
The nadis are crossing in the body. Where the chakras are, the nadis are crossing.
He opens the skull. He makes an analysis, but he doesn't understand where thoughts are stored, where imaginations are stored, where understanding is stored. Even though it's a mystery for doctors.
Yeah, they're making some analysis of the frontal lobe, the memory cortex is in the frontal lobe. But anyway, as you say, they don't understand fully, for sure.
That's God's grace. Pillai Lokacharya's Sri Ramayana Bharatati Tani Shlokam. And it's a very elaborate explanation of a few shlokas from the Ramayana and Mahabharata. very selected shlokas. In Ayodhya Kanda, there were only 10. From Mahabharata, it will be more. But beautiful explanations are given with analogies and so on. Whenever time it permits, rather the occasion arises, I will also give you the gist of those ideas, so that it is not enough that we study Ramayanam or Mahabharatam or Gita Artha Sangraha. So the Gita verses also will come inside, especially Charma Shloka, Sarvadharman Parityajya, and some more verses like Paritranaya Sadhunam, Yada Yada Hi Dharmasya, and some important shlokas will come into his explanation. And Tenacharya Sampradaya regards that book very greatly, and therefore we have to. Now
What's the name of the book again?
Sri Ramayana Bharatadi Tani Shlokaha. Tani is individual, or special, extraordinary, which need our attention.
By Pillailokacharya, and is there any commentary on it apart from Pillailokacharya, or?
I don't think, because our entire book is in Tamil. The commentary is also in Tamil. The method of Moolam, the text is giving lot of quotations from other sources to support the meanings of the shlokas of Ramayana and Mahabharata. But the Vyakhyanam, the first part of the page, half the page of each commentary, Moolam, will contain so many quotes. But beneath the first half, the second half of the page will be devoted to the commentary with the source, exact source, the number of the chapter, the number of the canto, and the number of the shloka, with the quotation sometimes in full. If the Moolam doesn't contain the full shloka, the bottom portion will have the full quotation. Each word was explained in detail, and there are very interesting points to understand. And because of people like you and others who have made me study compulsorily all these books, so that my lifetime is spent usefully. And I also, of course, listen to my own discourse in Mumbai on Krishna Trishna Tattvam from Gita Artha Sangraha. And therefore, I also can throw light on certain thoughts that creep into our mind.
Kavitarkika Simhaya Kalyana Gunashaline श्रीमते वेंकटेशाय वेदांत गुरवे नमः.